Hey there, YouTube family, and welcome to my channel. My name is Bradson, and welcome to episode 4 of the Creating a Unity MMORPG Multiplayer Game Series. In the last episode in our series, we took a little bit of time to look at the basics of how to create a Unity MMORPG project. That included importing the MMORPG framework, that included adding a network manager object, and also adding a network object component to a player object. In this episode, we take it to the next level. We're going to be taking an existing project and starting to add in those principles we used in our last episode, as well as looking at network behaviors and how we can really make our game start to feel real. This episode will be the first step in many of us creating our multiplayer game. There's going to be a lot more that we do, and just know from this point on, everything that we do will be additive, meaning the episode before and the episode after are going to be connected, meaning that we're going to start where we ended in a previous episode and continue moving forward in the process. If you haven't already, I encourage you to look back at the first 3 episodes in our series just to get an overview of what we'll be doing and how things work so that you can be in the best possible place as we continue on in this episode. But before we get started into today's episode, I want to take a few seconds to ask you to go ahead and like this video. If you feel like this content is meaningful and helpful, that like tells me a lot and helps other people know, amplifies this video out there to the YouTube verse. And if you're so interested in this content that you feel like you'd want to continue learning more, please don't forget to subscribe and continue checking out the videos on this channel. So enough talking from me, let's go ahead and jump into our Unity project. All right, so let's go ahead and get started in today's lesson, in today's steps. So as you might already notice, we're actually starting in the project that we created in our last episode. So this is just the base scene with some simple network manager objects in it and different things like that. So today we're not gonna be working in this. We're gonna actually be working in a whole new scene, and I've actually provided some of the assets that we're gonna need for that scene for you. I'll be putting a link in the description, but we'll get there in a second. But before we get it started, I did want to make a quick mention that I think is really important for everybody as we continue in this series and as we continue building on our multiplayer game. So I'm going to flip over really quickly here to a new page. I'm actually going to show what is the API overview of the Unity Multiplayer Networking Framework. The reason I'm showing this is because as we progress through the series and as you build your own games, it's going to be really important to make sure that you are aware that the API exists and that there's a place that you can get information about it. So if you're looking into things about the network manager or network variable or anything else, and you want to learn a little bit more about the details, it's really important that you check out this page. So flipping back over to our project, our whole goal for today is that we're going to be taking a pre-existing project and implementing Unity Network into it. So we're going to be going through some of the process that we went through in our last episode, but we'll also be jumping into a little bit about the network behavior and also a little bit more about the network manager and network objects. So let's go ahead and get started. So what we're going to go ahead and do is we're going to flip over and we're going to open a folder or wherever you have it housed with the package that I've shared with you in the description. This is gonna be really great because it's gonna save us a lot of time. So I'm gonna go ahead and open it. And as you see, it'll want to import some Unity packages. There's a lot of stuff in here. I'll talk a little bit about as we go into it, but let's go ahead and import. All right, our import is all done. It probably took about 30 seconds to a minute to get it all done because it was a little bit hefty, had some stuff in there. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is we're gonna go on down here in our project and we're gonna click scenes. Within scenes, which is within the assets area in our project area, we're gonna click on here and click multiplayer episode 4. All right, so all we're gonna say in this situation is we're just gonna go ahead and say manual fix. Don't worry too much about that. As we get into this package, there's gonna be a lot that we're doing, but it's set up a little bit so that we're gonna have to fix it. So just go ahead and click manual fix when you see that issue, if you get that issue. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I have this weird missing prefab, which we'll definitely bring back in a little bit. Let's go ahead and just delete it from our scene because it's something that we'll need later in the road. So as you see, we already have this scene. The scene is actually a multiplayer scene using some Unity assets that were retrieved from the Unity asset store. And really what it is a giant arena that we'll be using for our upcoming multiplayer game. What this multiplayer game is all about is that we're gonna have some cars that are gonna be driving around and battling each other in this arena. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna be using this map to do that. As I might have previously noted, I've worked in multiplayer games before, and I've actually worked in UNet previously, and I made a small multiplayer game prototype, and we're actually gonna recreate that prototype using Unity's netcode. All right, now that we have our package all implemented, there's really a few things that we're gonna need to do. The first thing that we're gonna need to do is go ahead and add our network manager into our scene. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna go up here, and we're gonna go game object and create empty. We're gonna go ahead in here and type network manager. This all might seem familiar from our last episode, so this should be pretty straightforward. Once we click on network manager and it's created, we're gonna click component, we're gonna go down to netcode, and we're gonna go ahead and click network manager. Just a side note, if you're starting a brand new project, not starting off the project that we use in episode 3, you're gonna need to go ahead and make sure that you import in Unity's netcode into your project. Otherwise, you'll get errors when you import the package. And also you won't be able to, you know, implement this network manager. So now that we have our network manager here, we're gonna go ahead and choose our transport. So go ahead and click select transport and click UNet transport. All right, for now, we're pretty much set up with our network manager, but we need to start getting things set up so we can actually play a game with our scene. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and come down here to what is called the prefabs. So within our prefabs, we've actually imported some new prefabs that we'll be using within our project today. And one of those is gonna be our player character, or more importantly, our car. So go ahead and select the folder that says netcode. Inside the netcode, you'll see what is a prefab called car player. Okay, let's go ahead and double click in here, because before we get this car player all situated and added to our scene, we need to set it up so that it can be used by our network manager and within our multiplayer game. So let's go ahead and double click on the car player. So what that should do is bring us into our prefab view. If you're familiar with Unity, this is probably something you're very familiar with, but essentially it just brings us into a view that we can see our prefab and all of the assets that are associated to it. Within this particular asset, you'll see on our CarPlayer ML API here in the top left. So now what we're gonna do is go over here on our right side and check out what our CarPlayer ML API has associated to it. So first you'll see on the right side, we have a rigid body and some scripts. Those scripts here, Easy Suspension and Drive, we're not gonna be using right now, but in later episodes in this series, we will need them, but we're gonna disable it. We'll talk more about that when we get to it. And as we scroll down, we'll see some more scripts. We'll see a health script, a car player script, box glider, an audio source, and a few other things. Really, the only things that really are gonna matter for us today are gonna be the car player script and the movement script. We're not gonna mess with the car player script, but it is how you are going to interact with the game with the car player, but we will be interacting with the movement script. So as you'll notice, the first thing is that our car player ML API object, our prefab, is not set up to be able to be enabled into our ML API game. So if you remember from my earlier episodes, it's important that any object that we have associated in our multiplayer game that we want to track over our network should have what's called a network object component. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is go up here to component. We're gonna scroll on down here to netcode, and we're gonna add network object. We're gonna scroll on down here to make sure it's all good. Everything looks good. We're not gonna change any default values, but now our prefab is situated in setup so that it can actually be used by our network manager and be seen in our Unity ML API game. So let's go ahead and back out of our prefab. Now let's go back here. Now we're in our main view. Let's go ahead and click on network manager. We're gonna go over here and scroll to the right, and we're now going to take this car player and we're gonna associate it to our player prefab within our network manager script. So let's go ahead and click and drag our car player. You'll see it pop up in the scene here for a moment, and we're gonna drop it into our player prefabs. Also, we're gonna need to go ahead and add this to our network prefabs list, because this is also telling our network manager script, hey, we need to manage this particular prefab over the network. So even though we've added it to the player prefab, we need to make sure we add it to network prefab. So let's go ahead and click this plus. We'll do the same thing. We're gonna click and drag this car player into network prefabs. Now we essentially have everything situated to go ahead and start our multiplayer game. So let's go ahead and click play. So So if you're playing this game, I have the audio on mute, but there is some audio that plays with it. It's like some little intro music, and it'll change when we actually start the game. But as you'll see, the first thing we'll see is a camera that's just showing us an overview of our map. In order to actually start our game, we're gonna need to actually go down here on our right side within our inspector view and click Start Host. And boom, our game is started. Now you'll see there's already a script to move our car around. It's missing some wheels. There's some reasons for that. We don't have to worry about it. But we have a game playing. We have our game, which is associated to a network object, and we can drive around and play it within our scene. So let's go ahead and stop. So one thing you might have noted when we joined into our game and we started playing is that we actually had to come over here and navigate to the right side of the screen and click Start Host in order to start our game. Now, in reality, this is not something that we're going to be able to do because we're not going to be playing our game within our Unity editor, but we're going to normally be playing it within some type of like windowed mode, or it's going to be published on some type of platform. So we need some way to start our host or start our server or client within our game. So what I did is I created a very simple script that will manage that for us so we can actually do it within the UI of the game. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is we're gonna navigate down here into the scripts folder, and you'll see there's a few different scripts, but what we wanna do is we want to go into the scripts that say netcode here in this folder. And in this netcode folder, we'll see a script that's called Start Game GUI. What we're gonna go ahead and do is click and drag our Start Game GUI, and we're gonna drop it on our network manager. So what is Start Game GUI? The Start Game GUI script is essentially just a simple script that allows us to interact with our network manager in a graphical user interface form. So let's go ahead and open our Start Game GUI script. So what you'll see in our Start Game GUI script is that it does a few simple things. And a lot of this code is actually not very unique code. You can actually get a lot of what we're doing here, this base setup, from some of the Unity sample code from the Unity networking library. But essentially all we're doing is we're creating the buttons for host, client, and server on our screen so that we can just interact and join as a host, client, or server in game. So I'll show you what that looks like really quickly. All right, let's go back and press play. And now when we start our game, we'll see the buttons host, client, and server. Once again, this makes it a lot easier for our lives because we won't have to do this in the Unity editor, but we'll also be able to do it when we publish the game. So I'm just gonna click host to show you that it's working. And there we go, the game is working. So let's go ahead and stop. Now that our Start Game GUI has been implemented, let's go ahead and do a test build to see if our networked game is actually working. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is gonna click File, and we're gonna go to Build Settings. I'm gonna pull over my Build Settings menu. What I'm gonna go ahead and do and say, Add open scene, and then I'm gonna go to player settings. I'm gonna go ahead and pull over player settings. Within our player settings, I'm gonna go ahead and change our mode from full screen window to windowed. And I'm also gonna go ahead and change our default screen width and screen height. And the only reason I'm doing this is so that we can check that our game is playing in the same screen or on the same monitor as our Unity editor. So I'm gonna change this to 800. By 600. All right, so really this is just setting this up so that we can do a quick view of our multiplayer game, see both windows at the same time. So I'm gonna go ahead and close this project settings, and I'm gonna go ahead and click build and run. I'm gonna go ahead and save my project name as test build within my project folder. I already had one, so I'm gonna replace, and I'm gonna let the game build. So it actually opened up on one of my other monitors, so I'm just gonna pull in here. But as you can see, we have our game, it's all published. It says host, client, and server. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do a test. I'm gonna go ahead and play our game within our Unity editor, and then I'm going to start that game as the host within our Unity editor, and then we're gonna join as a client in our published game. And I'm gonna go ahead and click play. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and click host to get the game started. And because of how I have the game set up right now, I have everybody coming in at the same position. We'll fix that in the future. I'm gonna move them back, our first player, just so that they don't fall on top of each other. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and switch to my other game, and I'm gonna click client. And just like that, we'll see that we have joined the game. Now, let's go ahead and try to play our game. I'm gonna play as the client here, and we'll see how the game is working. Let's just back up, turn around. Let's let the camera readjust. Oh, wait, you see, there's a strange artifact happening. Let's try it in our host. Yeah, as you can see, when I move one player, it moves the other. And we're also not seeing the player movement from one player to another reflected on the server. So let's go ahead and get started in trying to fix this issue. This is actually a common issue that you would have if you were using this kind of setup. And by doing a few things within our scripts, using network behaviors and some of the capabilities that it has, we can fix this issue pretty quickly. So let's go ahead and stop our game in our Unity editor. And let's also do the same with our game playing in its own window. Now, like I said, we had some issues. What we saw out of the box is that, yeah, our game is generating our players in the game, but what happens is that one player is actually controlling the movements of another, and we need to fix that. So a lot of that comes from an issue that comes from just using standard mono behaviors instead of network behaviors that don't really understand that we're in a networked scenario and how that would affect the gameplay. So in order to really understand what I'm saying, let's go ahead and look at a particular script, and I'll try to walk you through and try to get you the understanding of why this is happening and how we can fix it. So let's go ahead and open up a script for our car. We're gonna open a script that's called movement. So I think movement is in our main script folder, and I'm gonna click movement here and open up our movement script. So within our movement script, it's a pretty straightforward script. All it does is we give our character or our car some type of speed, and we give it some type of rotation speed, and we're just using some general movement, you know, calculations to kind of set up our movement. Really, all of our movement is coming here with the var input get axis horizontal, var z input get axis vertical. So now that we've looked kind of at how the script works, we need to think about how can we make sure that this script only works on one player at a time. So let's go back to our game and look at our prefab, which is our car. So I'm gonna go ahead and go to prefabs. I'm gonna go to network netcode and open up car object. All right, I'm gonna switch over here to scene. So as you may have noticed on our car player ML API game object, there's a script called movement. So let's take a few moments to think about why this movement script is having an issue within our multiplayer game. So one thing to note about this movement script, and as we looked at with the code, is that all it does is it looks at the inputs that a player puts in the game, and it moves a car player depending on those inputs. You may have noticed that when we're actually associating our car player to our network manager's player prefab object, that it's actually just generating this exact prefab into our game. So if there's two players in the game, two of these instances of car player actually are generated in the game. And what's actually causing the issue is that both of those instances of car player use the same exact script to manage the controls of car player. So we need to find some type of way to tell the code to only listen to the inputs for our particular player and not for other players that are in the game. Well, Unity Networking actually was aware that this would be a problem and actually created a set of different things that will allow us to actually enable that functionality. So let's go ahead and go back to our movement script and look at how we can try to solve this issue. So back at our movement script, we need to think to ourselves, how can we stop this code from running on every single car player that would exist in the game, and to make sure that it only runs on one car player, which is us, while we are playing the game? Well, it's pretty straightforward, and I'm gonna walk you through the process of how to do it. So the first thing we need to do is actually change our movement script, this movement class, from a mono behavior to a network behavior. So let's go ahead and add in here network behavior. As I mentioned in a previous video, mono behavior is actually the base class for network behavior. Network behavior just extends mono behavior and adds some new functionality. And we're actually gonna be using that new functionality to make our lives easier. So I'm gonna introduce you to the concept of is local player. So I'm gonna add in here a conditional that is if is local player and then squiggly brackets. So what is local player? The best way to think about it is that in a network behavior, isLocalPlayer is essentially a flag that identifies if a particular script is running on the player that is local to us. So think about isLocalPlayer as a way of differentiating yourself as a player from all other players in a network game. So let's see how this will work. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is we're gonna grab all this code that we wrote for our character controller, and we're gonna cut it and paste it within our isLocalPlayer condition. So basically what's happening here is that our character movement, our character controls will only be attributed to us, the local player in a network game. In other words, when multiple prefabs of the same type are generated into a network session, this will only run on one version of that prefab, and that prefab will be the version that we're in control of. So let's go ahead and save this movement script and see how this would work in action. So let's go ahead and flip back to our Unity editor. Let it load a little bit here. We're gonna go ahead and exit our prefab. We're gonna stay in our scene view. So let's go ahead and test everything out. So we're gonna go ahead and go to File, Build and Run, and go ahead and let the application build, and then we'll check out what happens. All right, so for whatever reason, my game player has decided to change its size, but I think originally there was maybe some type of issue, but it doesn't really matter. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is go ahead and run our Unity editor version of the game and act as host, and then we're gonna see if our fix has worked. So let's go ahead and click host. Let's do the same thing and back up a little bit. Then let's go ahead and switch to our game here and click client. And let's go ahead and go back to our host session and see now if we move both players. It looks like our isLocalPlayer addition has fixed the issue. So just a reminder of what this all is doing is isLocalPlayer just makes sure that any particular code only runs on our local player and not other networked players that might be in our gaming session. So just to show you to make sure that's working, if we go back to our other game and we go ahead and turn our car around, we'll see that we are not controlling the other player either. But as we're doing this testing, you might have noticed that there is something wrong. Let's go ahead and flip back to our Unity editor. Every time that we move our particular player, we're actually not seeing the changes that is happening in the other game. So if we go back to our other game, it looks like our, you know, host player hasn't moved at all, but our local player has definitely moved, and we've seen it move in its game. And similarly, we haven't seen this player's character move either. Now, this is a big issue and it has a solution. But in this particular video, we're not going to cover that solution. The reason being is that this is gonna get a little bit deeper. We're gonna have to go more into the code. And in order to make this video not extremely long, I'm gonna go ahead and stop here with what we've done so far, which is simply being able to add our network manager into our game, add our prefab network object into the game, and also fix some of the issues that are common when you're starting to make a networked game. In our next episode, we're gonna spend the time fixing this issue. We're gonna go deep into the ideas of network behaviors, network variables, and RPCs in order to solve this problem. So make sure to stick around for the next episode as we'll go deeper into exactly how we're gonna use Unity's MLAPI framework in order to solve this problem. So in this episode, we cover quite a bit, from importing in our game project, setting up our network manager and all the associated components, setting up our UI so we could start our host, and even just fixing some issues using a network behavior to make sure that the game begins to operate properly. But what you can probably tell just from how we ended today's episode, there's still a lot more work to be done. In our next episode, we're going to really be focusing on fixing the issues that we ended with in this particular episode, and we're going to start tackling the ideas of the RPC, the network variable, and the network transform. In order for our project to truly be a multiplayer game experience, these concepts and these principles are things that we're going to really need to understand and things that we're really going to need to dig into. So next episode is going to be a great one, and we're going to learn a ton. As always, thank you for checking out this video, checking out this series, and visiting my channel. I appreciate every single one of you. Thank you, YouTube family, for all of your support. And until next time, peace. Bow!